Howdy do to all of you. Welcome to the inaugural Keeping It 100 podcast. Thank you guys for being patient with me as I figure out this whole thing, how I'm going to brand it, what I'm going to name it, all of that stuff. We finally come to a conclusion on it, and I'm pretty happy with the name Keeping It 100, which gives me an excuse to use a Slaughterhouse instrumental as the intro song. That's what you're hearing there at the top of the show. And yeah, I just wanted to record a little segment here just to basically say that this is what the show is going to be. It's going to be me figuring out what I like in video games or what I like over other things. Basically, long story short, for those of you who are just joining us, this is a podcast in which I figure out the order for my top 100 games. People know I love video games. I know I love video games, but I never really made a giant list of like all of my favorites. I've only had a top 10 forever, and I've kept track of that. So I wanted to go ahead and see how it would be to make a bigger list than 10. Initially, it was 50, and now it is 100. And that's what we're sorting through on the podcast here. If you want to get the first episode where I started this whole thing, that's going to be the special segment of the last episode of the Players Club podcast in this exact same feed. So you guys can go ahead and check it out there. If you're listening to this on YouTube, it will also be on YouTube. So you can go ahead and listen to it there. But for the rest of us, you already know what this is. I'm just going to be going different battles. We're going to pit each game head to head to each other, and I have to decide which one I like more. We're going to continue that process until we eventually get to the end of the series. There's only going to be a limited series, planning on it being 9 more episodes. This is going to be the first standalone episode. There's going to be 8 more after this, at least. We might do some type of final episode to wrap everything up, but no promises on that quite yet. But yeah, this is the show, and these are going to be basically the audio versions of streams that I'm doing when I'm sorting all of these. So if you do hear references to visual aspects, hopefully there aren't too many. I tried to, you know, keep that to a minimum during the stream. So that's why that is there. But yeah, without further ado, we're going to go ahead and pitch it to myself from the slight past, and we'll continue the podcast. And I will see you guys hopefully in the next episode, and hopefully you guys enjoy this one. Adios. Welcome back, y'all. Welcome back to the sorting of my top 100 games once again. Now, I'm going to keep it real with you. This music's a tad bit loud, and I don't want it to drown my voice out. Once again, troubleshoot if you hear things being wonky or things not really working in the stream. Let me know in the chat so I can make sure to troubleshoot that before we go too far. But hey, we're back here. Once again, we're going to look through these games. Last time we did 1 to 10% sorted. Now we're going to do, I'm going to do at least another 10%. We'll see how long it takes. I don't want this to be more than 2 hours. For those of you who listen to the podcast version on VGU.TV podcast, it was a long time. It took a long time to get through it because we had the regular podcast for like an hour and a half. Then I had this section, which was another hour and 40 minutes. So the podcast was almost 3 hours long. It was crazy. But we're going to try and make this one a little bit brief, even though it will be a standalone podcast. So let's go ahead and start with battle number 35. 10% sorted. Ooh, boy. This one is BioShock versus Kane and Lynch 2 Dog Days. Now, I said at the end of the last stream we did / last podcast that I recorded, I said this was going to be a hard matchup. This isn't actually a hard matchup. It's just an interesting matchup because this just like encapsulates my stupid energy sometimes. It's just funny because BioShock, of course, a classic everyone loves. I enjoy that game quite a bit as well. But I have Kane and Lynch 2 Dog Days on here just because I love the style of that game so much. I just think it's so cool how it, you know, as that grainy, you know, looks like discarded video effect. I think that's so awesome. So that's why I have it on here, really. Like I talk about, its gameplay isn't that amazing. It doesn't feel that great to play, but I excuse that so much for the style. I am such a glutton for style. Like I love me some really cool stylish games, even if that style isn't like platinum type style. It's a little bit more gritty than that. But we're going to go ahead and pick BioShock here because BioShock really does have the whole package. For as much as I love Kane and Lynch 2 for that one aspect, I like BioShock for a wider array of aspects. So let's click BioShock for this one. Ooh, oh wow. Okay, finally we got some more recent games getting matched up here. Media Molecule's Dreams versus Metro Exodus for battle number 36. This one's a little challenging. Really, these are both games that I feel I haven't played enough of. In the case of Metro Exodus, I've played maybe, I probably put 10 to 15 hours into it so far. But I'm not done with the game. I haven't reached the conclusion. And Dreams is a game where I've beaten the campaign, the story mode, I've played all the way through. But there are so many levels out there. There are so many different creations, you know, albums and short films, all types of stuff out there. And I've only dipped my toe in. I played a lot of it closer to release. But since then, I haven't been playing it every single night. So I've just been adding things to my queue. I'm ready to hop back in at some point. But which one do I like more? I'm thinking, I don't know. Thinking about these two, Metro Exodus kind of fits like a glove. Like it's just a really good gameplay loop of exploration, rewarding you for resources, crafting, and also really interesting interactions with NPCs where you don't have to shoot everybody. You don't have to come to every encounter, you know, guns a-blazing. Let me make sure Audacity's recording. Yeah, we're good in Audacity. We are good in Audacity. Okay, yeah, we're fine. Just got close to the mic to make sure things are spiking. I'm paranoid. I'm sorry. But yeah, Metro Exodus just really does have that really good blend of a lot of stuff I like, you know, satisfying combat, really interesting weapons, gorgeous graphically. Narrative has some of those hooks that I like where, oh, you get to, there's a little girl on the train now, you get to get her little teddy bear. And just like the camaraderie of different characters, I love that stuff. But I feel I'm going to vote for Dreams here because for as much as I like the parts that already exist in Metro Exodus, the things I've seen from Dreams campaign mode make me so excited to see what people are going to make in the future using those same tools, because I mean, Dreams is just really impressive. And I feel like the promise of Dreams is so much better than the guarantee of Metro Exodus. Like, and I've played a couple things in Dreams that have just blown me away. And that blown away feeling is something I get more consistently from Dreams than I do Metro Exodus. So we're going to go ahead and select Dreams here. Battle number 37, Life is Strange versus Prototype 2. Hot damn. I feel like I got to justify Prototype 2 being on here. Prototype 2 is just one of those games where I loved it, absolutely adored it. You know, great platinum. I actually got it free for PlayStation Plus, played it twice because you had to beat it on hard mode as well for the platinum. And it's one of those podcast games, man. Just turn off the story. I skipped through all the cutscenes. By the time I was halfway through the game, I was like, this story's boring and bad. I don't want to hear this guy scream at people anymore. So I just turned all that off, put on a podcast, and just fly around the city, you know, hack up people, blow stuff up. It was a blast. I really enjoyed that game. But Life is Strange, dude. Life is Strange is probably the one that's going to win here because Life is Strange has such a massive impact on me as a person. Like, I've talked about it. I've talked about it in other places on the internet, but Life is Strange is just a great video game. Like, the strong narrative, those relatable characters, and I'm a sucker for narratives that are, you know, very tropey, very typical of a certain style or a certain type of entertainment, and then it has a twist. And that's what I like about Life is Strange, where it has that twist of the time manipulation stuff with the typical young adult narrative that you get from, you know, characters and stories like these. So yeah, Life is Strange, I dig quite a bit. And I think I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to choose Life is Strange on this one. I think gameplay wise, Prototype 2 is miles better than Life is Strange, but the impact of the narrative and characters of Life is Strange is just so much more to me. So yeah, Life is Strange is going to hit it. Ooh, okay. We're trying to mess with Burnout, or we're trying to mess with Prototype 2 right now. Battle 38 is Burnout 3 Takedown versus Prototype 2. Whew. Now, this one's really hard. This one's super hard. This is, it's really going to just be a battle between how much do I, because Burnout 3 is another one of those games where I played it a lot growing up, haven't played it a lot in the last few years, number one, and I haven't, how do you say, it's not one of those games, I never beat it. That's the phrase I'm looking for. I don't know why it took me so long to get there. Yeah, I enjoyed that game a whole lot. But really, I look at Burnout 3 as the gateway to get me into the Burnout series, because I didn't play 2. Of course, I didn't play 1. Burnout 3 is really what took it to the next level for everybody. Like, Burnout 3 is the Uncharted 2 of that franchise. And then they just made great games after. But I'm trying to compare that nostalgic feeling of, you know, getting takedowns in Burnout 3 and like the signature takedowns and everything and doing all the fun stuff in that game. Was that really on the level of Prototype 2 or not? Because Prototype 2 is a game I love purely for gameplay, and Burnout 3 is a game I love purely for gameplay. This is hard, and I hate, this feels wrong, but I'm really feeling Prototype 2 winning this one. And I know that's blasphemous, but Burnout 3 isn't even my favorite Burnout game, so I feel it would be disingenuous to put it that high, where Prototype 2, as I go through it, it's like, yeah, Prototype 2, horrible story and all that crap, but man, I don't know if dopamine is the right thing in your brain, but just the satisfaction of collecting all the collectibles in Prototype 2, gliding, flying around, running up stuff, throwing cars, chopping people up with the melee abilities. It was just so much fun, man. And it was fun for so much longer, for a wider amount of time that kept my attention, where Burnout 3, I can't really say that. Maybe not fair, because I was way younger when Burnout 3 came out, but I think I'm going to do it anyway. Prototype 2, I have to vote for here. I don't feel great about it. I really don't, but we're going to go ahead and hit it. Let's do it. That didn't feel great. Did not feel great, but I had to do it. Here we go. Another difficult decision. For battle number 39, we have Warhawk versus The Club. I'm going to take a sip of my Gatorade. Now, this one's going to be interesting. Now, how so? Warhawk is basically the multiplayer game that got me into multiplayer gaming. It's the first multiplayer game that I had on PlayStation 3. That is when it came out. First multiplayer game I had there, and I was just instantly in love, you know, the variety of combat, not with just the different weapons as a foot soldier, but all these different ships and vehicles and planes and all this stuff. Just really cool battlefield mechanics, and, you know, one of my favorite games to this day on the PlayStation 3. But The Club, I don't know, man. The club is like comfort food, but comfort food that I find myself craving very often, like to a weird degree, where Warhawk is like, oh yeah, I have those memories and I was addicted to it at one point in time. Whenever I think about The Club, I'm always like, yo, I could play some of that right now and have some fun, in a way where Warhawk, besides the fact that the servers technically don't exist, there's a workaround. You can use an Android app to get online with Warhawk now, but that's besides the point. Warhawk, I think of, and it's like, that was fun. I don't know if it would be fun now. Where The Club, I know for a fact it would be fun now, because I still have fun when I play that, because I have it on PC with the higher frame rate and everything. I think that game is so much better than even when I fell in love with it playing the demo on PlayStation 3. So I'm going to go ahead and vote The Club for this one. Feels a little bit blasphemous, but I have to be honest with myself. The Club's one of my favorite games, and I know I bring it up as an obscure thing all the time, but I legitimately enjoy that game. So The Club it is. Battle number 40, Deep Rock Galactic versus Ape Out. Oof. This one is going to be interesting. Now, Deep Rock Galactic, I believe I've already talked about. It's kind of blurring together between the podcast we did for this sorting and for those other 7.5 hours of podcast we did for the other sorting that ended up falling through. It's kind of hard to remember which is which, but we're going to try and stay on this one. Deep Rock Galactic versus Ape Out. Deep Rock Galactic, of course, is the Starship Troopers meets Minecraft meets Left 4 Dead combination of gameplay that I really, really like and enjoy. Played it on PC a whole lot, but haven't played that much of it. Ape Out's a similar case, where I started that on PC as well. Haven't played that much of it. I've beat maybe 2 of the albums, and I think there's 6 total? Somewhere around there. But I enjoyed Ape Out a whole lot. And I still, I mean, I feel weird using past tense verbs for these because I do intend to go back to them. But Ape Out, I'm starting to see what I'm going to differentiate these two on. Because the reason that both of these games stuck out to me is that Ape Out had a very just arresting visual style that really caught your attention. And the same is true for Deep Rock Galactic, where it just catches your attention as soon as you see it. You're like, oh man, that's very vibrant. It's very colorful. It's a very interesting game. And, you know, I got to see what it's about. Same thing for Ape Out. It was like, oh man, that's some interesting design there. I got to see what's up with that. The thing that I think is going to win out in the end, though, is they both share that trait of being very visually interesting. But the gameplay in Deep Rock Galactic is just so much deeper, so much more complex, and it leads to so many more interesting stories of fun gameplay. Because the best games, as we all know, have good stories. So when I say have good stories, I can mean that in the sense of your Red Dead Redemption 2s, your Last of Us, your God of War 2018s. I like the stories in the ones before those, but you know, we're not talking about God of War right now. So it can have a good story in that way, or it can have a good story in the gameplay moments you have, either with friends or with yourself, of just overcoming adversity at the last second, or just getting a really quick succession of headshots or jumps or anything of the sort. Deep Rock Galactic lends itself a lot to those types of moments where it is a multiplayer shooter, co-op Left 4 Dead type shooter. And, you know, those moments where you get to the extraction point right as a swarm of bugs are coming up on you and you're all out of ammo, or those moments where you mine some minerals and it ends up being the last mineral you need to call down a supply drop and finally give ammo to the rest of the squad. So many great moments like that in Deep Rock Galactic, where Ape Out has some pretty cool moments. It is Hotline Miami-esque, so you are going to have some really fun moments of, you know, taking out a bunch of enemies in quick succession or dodging a bunch of them in quick succession. You're going to have moments like that, but I think they're so much more deeper, so much more complex, and so much more often in Deep Rock Galactic. So I'm going to go ahead and vote for Deep Rock Galactic. I don't feel great about that, but I think that's where I truly stand on the matter. Battle 41, Torchlight 2 versus Ape Out. Now, actually, these are completely opposites, where both of the last games had, you know, very interesting art styles. Ape Out is a game I like primarily for its style, and Torchlight 2 is a game I like primarily for just its gameplay. Visually, it's not an ugly game by any means. It is a little bit dated now, but it's not like a hideous game. You know, artistically, it's not bad at all. There's nothing wrong with it in that respect. But it's just so generic to me that I just forget about it. Ooh, excuse me. Torchlight 2, I just click the heads and watch the stats go up and collect all the resources. And that's my entire relationship with Torchlight. Where Ape Out, as I've already said, just not just the artistic stylings, but the music and how it's dynamic with your gameplay. I really, really dig that aspect, and I dig all of those aspects of Ape Out. And despite me, I haven't beaten either of these games, but despite me saying the negative things, or I didn't really say that much negative about Ape Out in the last battle, but despite me loving both of these games, I really do enjoy the gameplay of Torchlight 2. Like, I really do enjoy that clicking, just level up and increase your character and everything. But there's already another game on this list that does that progression of getting your characters to be super strong, does that progression more effectively than Torchlight 2 does, despite being in a different genre entirely. But what I'm thinking it comes down to is that Torchlight 2's mechanics, to me, I feel like I'm full of shit here. To me, Torchlight 2 feels like a shallow game gameplay-wise. Not to say that there's not a lot of different combat options and stuff, but from the sheer, like, moment-to-moment, when I play Torchlight 2, all it is, all right, I'm clicking. Maybe I'm hitting some buttons in the number row, but that's about it. I never think maybe I should be worrying about my position and stuff, but I never think about my position. I never think about like, oh, what's in my inventory that I can use right now. I'm just trying to just spam my mana potion and just keep my abilities going the entire time. And it's really just about out DPSing every enemy you come across and just trying to balance all of your resources to do so. Where Ape Out is like, the Ape Out, its style is just so gorgeous, so luscious, so vibrant, and it's not skin deep either. It ties into the game in so many really nice ways, you know, with the title screen sequences and the whole, just the layout of the game being in the form of like albums. I really, really love that. So I think overall, I'm going to have to hand it to Ape Out in this one. Respect the Torchlight 2, but Ape Out, I got to give it to this one. Battle number 42, Spider-Man 2018 versus Control. This one's a little rough. Yeah, really, the only reason I feel it's rough is because I know I'm about to do Control dirty. Spider-Man is just, we've talked about it before. I think we talked about it on the last episode of these, on the last podcast / last stream. Spider-Man 2018 is just such a wonderful game to just play. Like, it's just so easy to consume. Just the combat's fun. The combat's varied. Movement is just, you can go exactly where you want to go and you know exactly how to get there. And it just, the ease with which you can be a badass Spider-Man is just so easy. Where in the Arkham games, it was fun to be Batman. And that came with all the, you know, kind of tanky controls and the very, I don't know, stoic nature of him. The flamboyance and fun of Spider-Man is felt in the very control system of Spider-Man 2018. And so I love that so much more. Where Control, of course, I love that world. Of course, I love the weapon system, the looting system. I think that was really smart. And I like a lot of characters as well. There's a lot to love about Control. But when it comes down to it, just the freedom that Spider-Man gives me, where I know Control, the whole point of it isn't to be free. It is a very oppressive environment and a very bureaucratic setting. Spider-Man is just so much more just, it makes me feel happier when I'm playing Spider-Man than when I do with Control. Where Control, I have fascination, but that stops once you've seen everything. Where Spider-Man, I just feel like I'm free. I feel like I'm flying. it just feels so freeing to play Spider-Man, despite me of having seen every inch of that open world. So yeah, Spider-Man's going to win this one. Battle number 43, Horizon Zero Dawn versus Control. And we're gonna pick Horizon Zero Dawn once again. Sorry for Control, but Horizon Zero Dawn, one of those games where the entire time I played it, I think it took me maybe a month total. 50 hours into the game, I got the platinum in it. And it was just pure bliss. Just the exploration, just, it's not even one of those games where it's like, what weird thing I'm going to see in this corner. It's just like every inch of that world is vibrantly colored. Just beautiful to see. And every animal, or I guess every robotic creature that you saw in that world was fascinating, interesting to look at. It was just a really good blend of a whole bunch of genres and elements for me that I just really enjoy Horizon Zero Dawn. I think gameplay wise, these games are very, very similar, actually, where it's about collecting your resources, light RPG elements, some skill trees, and stuff like that, where Control has a little bit more in the mobility sector for you to run around and fly around, where Horizon Zero Dawn is a lot more grounded. But Horizon Zero Dawn just, actually, a big reason Horizon Zero Dawn really got me is how beautiful its world was and how pleasant it was to just be in that world. Where Control, I wouldn't say it's pleasant to be in that world, but it did captivate me in a similar way to Horizon. I still think Horizon Zero Dawn comes out on top just because, I don't know, overall, I like the characters in Horizon Zero Dawn more than I like the characters in Control. With Control, I was like, look at all these weird, quirky people. In Horizon Zero Dawn, I was actively making ships for Aloy. I'm going to go ahead and give the slight nudge to Horizon Zero Dawn. I think I would come away from Control more positively if that photo mode was there at launch. I bought it as soon as it came out, absorbed it as soon as I could, And I think if I had that photo mode, it would get me to appreciate the environments in that game even more than I already do. But Horizon Zero Dawn has to win in this matchup. Battle number 44, Watch Dogs 2 versus Infamous 2. And we're at 12% sorted, by the way. This one is interesting, which I think is something I'm going to say for a lot of these battles as I take another sip of Gatorade. I'm glad I announced that sip of Gatorade, because the audio listeners probably just heard a and were like, what the fuck was that? This man just let one loose on mic. But in any case, now, initially, I thought this one wasn't going to be hard. Infamous 2 was my favorite game of all time, hands down, for many, many years up until I played Saints Row 4. And I still love that game. But Watch Dogs 2, just the characters, I don't usually like stealth games, but the way that Watch Dogs 2 did stealth really made me enjoy the methodical pace of learning enemy walking patterns and getting up behind them with my different gadgets and just, you know, really working on the fly. I really enjoyed that in Watch Dogs 2. And just the tone. Like, Watch Dogs 2, it was so fun being, you know, Marcus and being happy-go-lucky, carefree, you know, running around like he didn't have a care in the world. That was really fun to do in Watch Dogs 2. And just tonally, that game just felt so joyous and happy. You know, I like that game a lot for that. But Infamous 2, gameplay-wise, I don't know. Let me get off of Twitter. Maybe that'll help me. I got the phone up here. Let me not do that to myself. You guys almost saw a really revealing thing that someone posted on Instagram. Goodness gracious. We're going to ignore that. But yeah, as I was saying, Infamous 2... I greatly enjoy Infamous 2. Really, it's just the gameplay of that game. That's another game where it felt freeing to just run around, traverse the environment. But in a way that I don't think other games have really done. Infamous 2, yes, you can traverse really fast and, you know, it's effortless to traverse. But it rewards you for using your environment to traverse. Where in a lot of these other open world games, you know, we talked about Prototype 2. I love that game. But in that game, you just run up a building and glide. That's like the meta of movement, and that's pretty much all you need to do. You run super fast, and you glide pretty fast as well. It's not really any... There's not really anything more to it, where in Infamous 2, yeah, you can run pretty fast, but the way to get speed is to find those lightning rails so you can grind along the light or the wires in the buildings and in the areas around town. You have to, you know... Especially in the flooded areas, you have to stay on rooftops. So it's all about jumping from rooftop to rooftop, hitting your little glide and just going from rooftop to rooftop that way. You're trying to climb a building. Look out for those little electric pole things to shoot yourself up a couple stories so you don't have to keep pressing X to jump over every ledge. It rewarded you taking advantage of your environment and actually looking out for those, power-ups, you could maybe call them, those temporary boosts of speed to make traversal even more fun. So that's a big reason why I like Infamous 2. Also the combat, just the way that you could map all your powers to different buttons at any time in the game. I thought that was awesome. I thought that was really, maybe not innovative, but a very player first type of gameplay design that I really enjoyed. And narratively, back when it came out, I really did choke up at that ending. I really was moved by some of those endings in Infamous 2. And as I talk about Infamous 2 more, I'm almost certain that I have to click it. It has the win over Watch Dogs 2. For as much as I enjoy Watch Dogs 2 and appreciate everything that game does, the things that Infamous 2 does still stick with me after all these years. So yeah, Infamous 2 is going to win that one. Whew, fuck. All right, here's a hard one. Battle 45, Ratchet & Clank: A Crack in Time versus Elder Scrolls 5 Skyrim. Oh, man, I feel like no matter what I choose here, I'm not going to be happy. Ratchet & Clank: A Crack in Time, I believe I've talked about in the previous episode, where I feel between that and Ratchet & Clank 2016 on PS4, which is what I consider to be maybe objectively the best Ratchet & Clank, I think it only gets that title because it is a highlight reel of Ratchet & Clank, where A Crack in Time is an actual original. It feels more like an authored Ratchet and Clank game, like with the specific design and with a specific creative vision, where Ratchet and Clank 2016 just feels like a highlight reel, as I said. But I love A Crack in Time. I think despite its issues, like those Clank levels were quite a bit challenging at the end to the point where I was a little bit frustrated. But, you know, I still made for a great game, you know, great set pieces, some really cool open environments as well, especially for the jet boot sections for Ratchet. I just loved all that stuff. A lot of good stuff in A Crack in Time. Or Skyrim has a very inviting structure to not just his gameplay, but to the entire design of the game, where it just invites you to explore its world by way of just the art being gorgeous, by you being rewarded by every single action in the game. And it rewards exploration so expertly in a way that I super duper appreciate. And really, A Crack in Time does something similar, but it just... A Crack in Time is just a shallower experience than Elder Scrolls is. Actually, let me not even say shallower. It's just strictly a shorter experience because it is a Ratchet and Clank game. There was maybe 30 to 40 hours of content total that I did to get the Platinum in Crack in Time, including playing it again on hard to get that trophy. Where Elder Scrolls Skyrim, I played for damn near 200 hours. So it is definitely a world that I've spent more time in. But it wasn't always fun. Like, at a certain point, Skyrim didn't feel like, it never felt like a job. It never felt like a chore to play. But at some point, it was just like, ooh, what adventure are we in today? It was a routine. I got into the groove of playing Skyrim every day for like a good, almost a year. Like, I played that game for a very, very long time because it was a big deal. It was a movement when it came out. Like, everyone was talking about that game in high school, back when it dropped. So this is how much do I love these games? And I'm not choosing like both. I'm not choosing no option. So I have to make a choice between A Crack in Time or Skyrim. Huh. I think when it comes right down to it, the actual moment-to-moment gameplay of A Crack in Time is stronger than Elder Scrolls V Skyrim. Where Skyrim melee combat is as deep as a puddle. It's really just swing at them, and then if you have a shield, maybe you can parry bash them. But really, it's the exploration of Skyrim that is really getting me. Where A Crack in Time, it's the production value of the narrative. It's the narrative itself. The narrative I remember was really cool. Some of the set pieces you do, where you're going back and forth between time and some levels. The more I think about Ratchet and Clank Crack in Time and just the unique ideas that were in that game, the more I think I like it more than Skyrim. And I love Skyrim. I absolutely adore Skyrim. But just because I played it more doesn't necessarily mean I love it more. So I'm going to have to go to Crack in Time because that was just a blast and just blew me away. I think the blow away factor is the primary factor I'm going to grade these on. So because of that, the blow away factor is bigger in Crack in Time. So we're going to go with A Crack in Time. That didn't feel great. I'm so sorry. Oh, Ratchet and Clank 2016 versus Elder Scrolls V Skyrim. Take another sip there. This is an interesting one where Ratchet and Clank 2016, we already talked about it. That's like a highlight reel of the entire franchise, where Skyrim is a, you know, it is what we just said. So to say between these two. Now, I voted for A Crack in Time because it had more, you know, it blew me away more. Ratchet and Clank 2016 never blew me away. It just gave me more of what I wanted and more of what I like. Like, I enjoy everything about Ratchet and Clank 2016. It hits every note correctly. But it didn't really blow me away at all. Or Skyrim, there were moments where it did blow me away. Like, you know, the first time you see a dragon, really just all of the parts of that game that any other game would treat as a big action set piece, Skyrim treats like an everyday thing that happens regularly throughout your play, like killing dragons and, you know, some of the not even some of the boss battles, just really killing dragons and earning shouts as well. Those feel like epic moments that in any other game would be like something you're building towards for multiple levels, where in Skyrim, it very well could just be something that's at the end of a dungeon. Like you just leave the dungeon and there's a dragon above and now you're in combat with a dragon. In a way where Ratchet & Clank 2016, despite being gorgeous, you know, production values over the moon, I think it's still somewhat, just a little bit somewhat by the numbers, by way of being the type of game it's being, giving a highlight reel of the best gameplay innovations of that franchise. So I'm going to have to click Skyrim on this one. I don't feel great about this one either, but I'm going to have to click it. I feel that's more authentic to me. So let's click it. 1, 2, 3. Shit. That didn't feel great. That did not feel great. Battle number 47 at 13% sorted, by the way. Burnout Paradise versus PlayStation All-Stars Battle Royale. Whoo, shit. Yeah, actually, this one isn't that hard. This one is going to go to Burnout Paradise. Literally my favorite racing game of all time. I adore that game, and I love everything about it. Just the world, the crashing, reckless gameplay. I love the tone of it, where it just treats cars like the cars in Burnout are Hot Wheels cars. They're not real vehicles. That's why they don't have brand names, and they really take advantage of that by being as reckless as possible. In the case of PlayStation All-Stars Battle Royale, I enjoy that game primarily because it is a crossover game. PlayStation has never had a crossover game, or at least none of that magnitude, or that all these different characters from all these different places. We're ignoring, you know, PlayStation Move Heroes and stuff like that. But I really, really, really did enjoy PlayStation All-Stars Battle Royale. But I can acknowledge that polish-wise, it was lacking. Character roster should have had some of those classic characters. I can acknowledge its flaws. Where Burnout Paradise, I have a hard time believing there's anything wrong with Burnout Paradise. And I'm sure there's something that I'm not thinking about, but I just have a harder time being sold on that concept. So I'm going to go ahead and vote for Burnout Paradise. The love for that one is more intense. Ooh, okay. Guacamelee versus PlayStation All-Stars Battle Royale for number 48. Man, I really feel weird. I don't want PlayStation All-Stars Battle Royale to be too low in my list, but I can already tell there's going to be a lot of games above it. Guacamelee is going to win this one. That's just, I associate the Vita with that game so heavily, and it's one of my favorite indie games of all time. You know, I absolutely adore that game. So much fun gameplay-wise. Story is, you know, kind of silly, meme-y, whatever, but just gameplay-wise, excellent, excellent stuff all around. So yeah, Guacamelee wins. Oh, okay. Battle 49, Wolfenstein 2, The New Colossus versus Doom 2016. Whew, fuck. All right, this is a really hard one because these are very similar games. They're both shooters, both Bethesda, both previously inspired by id game classics. Now, Wolfenstein 2, I like primarily for its narrative. I think its narrative is one of the best I've ever played in any game, shooter or not. Great characters as well. Just some really cool, crazy moments in that game that I just never thought anyone would even try in a game, let alone pull off so successfully. But gameplay wise, that game is really, really difficult. It's really, really hard to play. It sometimes gets annoying, just trying to play through that game because you just die so quickly, especially in the beginning before certain upgrades are required. It's just really, really hard to keep your health up in all these firefights. And even though the gunfights are satisfying in their own right, you never want to leave cover because you die in like 4 hits sometimes. So that's something I can hold against that. Where Doom 2016 felt fair. It felt like its whole philosophy is to get you into the fight, be aggressive, take out enemies. And as soon as you take out an enemy, your health is back at full from the pickups. And it incentivizes that gameplay so effectively, where Doom 2016 was just fun all the way throughout. And despite narratively, there's not really much there. Yes, people love the Doom Slayer, and they love the fact that he's just like, you know, this destructive force of fuck you to everyone who's trying to like impose rules or restrictions. He doesn't give a shit about any of that, and he'll just barrel right through. I know people love that, and I love that too, but it's just so... it's so subtle and it's so much in the background of Doom 2016 to where it's not a big deal to me. Like, I play that game mainly for the gameplay, and I love the multiplayer in Doom 2016 as well. Ultimately, I'm going to go ahead and choose Doom 2016 here because gameplay-wise, I mean, I said it before, Doom 2016 is if Ratchet and Clank was a violent first-person shooter. Those two franchises have so much in common, and I just have to give it to them, man. Doom 2016 is a great game. I'm excited for Eternal to come out in a couple days, so I'm going to choose Doom 2016 here. Love that narrative of Wolfenstein 2, but you will get your day in the sun, Wolfenstein 2. Battle number 50, Tales from the Borderlands versus Wolfenstein 2, The New Colossus. Yeah, how about that narrative I just got done talking up? Yo, this is going to be interesting. It's really difficult. Okay, here's how I'm going to... Ooh, that doesn't even work. What I was going to say is that Tales from the Borderlands... Now, both of these games I love for their narratives. That's why this choice is so hard. Tales from the Borderlands is primarily a comedic game in which not a lot of the comedy hit. There is some drama. The drama stuck out to me so much because this is supposed to be primarily a comedy game, primarily a comedic universe that it's set in. And when it does get into that drama, it was so much more effective to me because I was just getting inundated with jokes minutes before. And it doesn't really do a tonal whiplash, but it does just, it those moments of drama stick out because of comedy. Where Wolfenstein 2, that game revels in tonal whiplash to the point where you're enjoying it. Like you'll be in one vibe the next minute, and then the next very level or even next scene, it'll be a completely different tone. It'll go into super duper serious to like literal poop jokes right after. It just like oscillates constantly. And I love how daring that is narratively. And it tackles some really hardcore mature themes, or not even mature themes, just like deep political themes that a lot of games are afraid to even touch. And I really appreciated that a game like Wolfenstein 2 did that and kept its humor, kept its goofiness, kept its campiness, kept every single aspect of its tone from the past while adding all these new and weird different elements from the present. So I think narratively, that's just so much more impressive than New Colossus. Tales from the Borderlands, I still do love, but I think I have to give the edge to Wolfenstein 2 because there are moments in Tales from the Borderlands that wowed me, that were super duper impressive. But Wolfenstein 2 is just so, man, the moments that stick out in Wolfenstein 2 stick out so much further than Tales from the Borderlands. So I have to vote Wolfenstein 2 here. Battle 51, Saints Row 2 versus Tales from the Borderlands. Another somewhat difficult decision because Saints Row 2 is a comedic game as well, while Tales from the Borderlands falls to that category. Gameplay-wise, Saints Row 2 was so much more compelling. It's a shooter, and people know I love my shooters. But it was just the way the upgrade system worked were just so much more they were like on a consistent path where it wasn't here's a random upgrade here, here's a random upgrade there. It was, oh, you want to upgrade your SMGs. All right, here's, you know, faster fire rate. How about we just give you two guns now? Now you can dual wield SMGs. And then it just continues on that linear path. Oh, you want to upgrade your reload speeds? How about upgrade? Okay, now there's no reloading. Now you just have one consistent clip that just goes on forever. And I really like that because by the end of the game, you just had unreasonably powerful weapons and unreasonably powerful vehicles and other items as well. And I really like that from a gameplay perspective and, you know, taking over the cities, doing all the side activities. I really enjoyed Saints Row 2. I feel weird about putting it above Tales from the Borderlands, though, because I think that narrative is just so outstanding. And Saints Row 2 has a, you know, fairly compelling narrative. There are moments, or at least one moment in Saints Row 2 that really shook me, that really stick out in my mind. But Tales from the Borderlands, that narrative just overall just smokes Saints Row 2 all over. But the gameplay in Saints Row 2 is so much better. And I think what I'm going to do here, which kind of goes against other rankings that I just had earlier in this stream/podcast episode, despite Saints Row 2 having better gameplay than Tales from the Borderlands, I'm going to give it to Tales from the Borderlands because I feel it isn't completely fair to say Oh, Saints Row 2 has great gameplay, where Tales from the Borderlands, because it's just a narrative-based game, it really doesn't have the room to have that much gameplay. And so I feel like I'm, cutting it off at the knees by just giving it that handicap right off the bat. So I think what I'm going to do is choose Tales from the Borderlands, because the moments that stick out from it, because, okay, actually I don't feel too guilty about this. Saints Row 2 gameplay was great and everything, but that gameplay was very much so my comfort food. There wasn't anything gameplay wise that stuck out as an innovation, as like a super special thing that I remember. Where Tales from the Borderlands, that narrative sticks out as a super special thing that I remember. So yeah, we're going to go ahead and choose Tales from the Borderlands. I thought I was going to feel more guilty about that, but I don't. So let's keep it going. Battle number 52, Shadow Warrior 2 versus Wolfenstein The New Order. This one isn't hard at all. I love Wolfenstein New Order. Narratively, I think it was great, but it did kind of lay a lot of that groundwork for them to really go off in Wolfenstein 2. Gameplay-wise, it was a lot of fun. Gameplay-wise, I enjoyed it more than the sequel because I did end up getting the platinum in that game. But Shadow Warrior 2 gets this one hands down. I've talked about it before. Shadow Warrior 2 does that Borderlands-style loot system, but instead of having a million guns, and because of that, your guns lose their value, and you never attach yourself to any gun, you don't build a relationship with that weapon, it just makes all that extra loot frivolous. Shadow Warrior 2 only has a handful of guns. I think there's less than 50 guns in the whole game. But you can put different socketable gems in there to change fire rates, clip size, elemental damage. You can turn it into a burst gun if you want. Changes the attributes so drastically, but still keeps it your same gun that you found, that you, discovered. And I think that's a really great way to solve that Borderlands loot system crisis that I've always had with the series. And so, yeah, Shadow Warrior 2 is going to win this one. Even though Shadow Warrior 2 doesn't really have that much interesting to say as far as narratively, gameplay wise is just so incredibly strong that I have to give it to it. All right, battle number 53, SteamWorld Dig 2 versus Wolfenstein The New Order. This one's interesting. I'm gonna take another sip of my Gatorade. Apologies if you heard that. I'm gonna act like no one heard that, but I will take a sip still. I got nose stuff going on, just things happening in that area of my nasal cavity. But anyway, SteamWorld Dig 2, I really enjoy for that progression. I really enjoy the progression of SteamWorld Dig 2, where it's all about mining, find some minerals, then climb back up, and then buy some upgrades, go back down, and then use those upgrades to find more minerals, and then complete the cycle and keep doing it over and over again. Exploration in that game's great. Narratively, not much there. But exploration is excellent. It's on Vita, and it's a great bite-sized title. I think it's on Switch as well. It's on damn near everything, I'm pretty sure. But yeah, it was just excellent for that. Enjoyed playing it on my Vita immensely. And it really did a lot of really cool movement mechanics that I really enjoyed, especially near the end. You start unlocking some really powerful movement mechanics. But really, SteamWorld Dig 2 sticks out primarily for its gameplay. Is that better than because here's the thing, Wolfenstein 1, its narrative's great, but compared to what 2 is, 1 feels so neutered, so like dipping your toe into it, where 2 submerges your whole body into it. And I feel like that, I don't know if that's a detriment to it, but it's definitely something that makes that game less special to me. Gameplay-wise, it is fun, but there's nothing super special about the gameplay, where it's a shooter. It's a fun shooter, but it's a shooter. You got some dual wielding of some of the weapons. You got some somewhat interesting weapons with like the little laser gun you get, and the upgrades you get for that are really cool. But I'm thinking it has to be SteamWorld Dig 2, which doesn't feel right because, I think actually, no, I'm not even going to feel guilt here. SteamWorld Dig 2, gameplay wise, is so much stronger than the gameplay of Wolfenstein New Order, to the point where I think it overrides the narrative of Wolfenstein The New Order, where the New Order definitely feels like it's setting the scene for them to really go off in the sequel, where SteamWorld Dig 2, by being a sequel, the tracks have already been laid. It's time to run the train right to the station. So SteamWorld Dig 2, I'm a vote for. Feels weird, but hey, I'm good with it. Battle number 54, Astrobot Rescue Mission versus Static. Interesting. Both of these are PSVR games. And in the case of Astrobot Rescue Mission, hopefully most people know that game. It's just, you know, Super Mario 64 for VR is basically what I think of that game. Excuse me, as being just a really awesome platformer, some really amazing set pieces that just really wow you with the VR perspective. But Static is a very awesome PSVR game as well, but it's more puzzle-based. It's a lot more low-key. Think Portal, but instead of using a portal gun, your DualShock 4 in VR, of course, is a puzzle box in which all the buttons on the DualShock 4 do something different. You have to figure out what the mechanics of that box are in order to solve the puzzle and progress to the next level. I really enjoy Static so much. That one really surprised and blew me away. Where Astrobot Rescue Mission, it surprised me and it blew me away also. I think this is a case of expectations where Astrobot Rescue, I'm going to start with Static, where Static, I had no expectations on that. It was really just a demo I downloaded because I just got my PSVR. I played that one first puzzle and I was like, yo, this is really cool, actually. This is really neat. Then I bought it with no other site, with no other information, no reviews or anything, and absolutely loved that game by the end of it. Where Astrobot Rescue Mission, I knew it was going to be good. People were already talking it up before I had gotten the game. I knew it was going to be great. And it even blew me away then, despite that. So I think for that comparison alone, both of these games have a really big like wow factor, really impressed me, really surprised me. But Astrobot Rescue Mission is just so, that's like one of the best games I've ever played, one of my favorite games I've ever played, and I still want to go back and get that platinum one day. So yeah, Astrobot Rescue Mission has to get it for this one. Who? Call of Duty World War II versus Static for battle number 55 at 15% sorted, by the way. Gee willikers. Now, I think I know which one's going to win here. For Call of Duty World War II, I've talked about not liking that single-player campaign. I think that single-player campaign was so boring, held your hand too much, you know, the whole nine yards, talked about it. Static, but the thing about World War II, Before I go to Static, the thing about World War II is that its multiplayer was so fun, very rewarding, very consistent with how the rewards were doled out, because as you know, they add a lot of these DLC weapons in Call of Duty where they come in loot boxes, but it was really fair to earn these loot boxes. You had contracts every day where you complete the contract, get a loot box, and sometimes instead of trying to hope for that one of those new weapons in a loot box, they straight up say, hey, get 500 kills here and we'll just give you the weapon, like just the base version so you can at least play with it. I really dug that, and I thought that was one of the fairest systems that Call of Duty multiplayer has ever implemented. I played that multiplayer a lot, despite not liking that single player campaign at all. But Static, man, I just said Static has that wow factor. It has that fascinating, intriguing thing to pull you in, and then it holds you and keeps you there for the rest of it. And I really enjoy that about Static. Despite there were some difficulty spikes in Static where, because it's a puzzle game, you're not thinking about using your reflexes that much. And then one or two puzzles do require you to like not be good with timing, but just to be fast enough for certain things. And it's like, oh boy, this is going to be hard. But it was gratifying to do. So because of Static having overall just more fun attached to it, I'm going to vote for Static here. Love the multiplayer in World War II, but Static here, just that whole experience was positive, where Call of Duty had a couple of negative spots. All right, Battle 56, Bioshock 2 versus Call of Duty Infinite Warfare. Shit's about to go down right now. All right, let me take a sip. All right. Call of Duty Infinite Warfare. I don't know if it's popped up on this list yet, but I love that one for that narrative, man. That narrative is Saving Private Ryan in space. And if you've seen that movie, I don't really have to say too much else to you. But it really strikes the similar emotional chords of that film. And it does that while having that Mass Effect 2 structure, where I wasn't the biggest fan of Mass Effect 2. It's not even on this top 100 list. Not that I hate it, it's just like, you know, if it was a similar case with Star Wars when I finally got around to watching Star Wars, you know, in my 20s. By the time I saw it, it was like, oh, every other movie has been copying this movie, So now that I'm seeing the original, it feels like it's generic like the rest of them. So not really fair. That's just all my fault. And so Mass Effect 2 was a similar case where, so Infinite Warfare copies that style, or not style, but copies that structure of go do the mission, come back to your home ship and, you know, talk to your friends, you know, change your loadout, do all these things and then choose your next mission to go. I really enjoyed that about Infinite Warfare, that single player. Multiplayer-wise was very fun as well. It was a bit of a melt fest. The time to kill in that game was damn near instant. But I did enjoy the game. It's just, I really don't have too much negative to say on Call of Duty Infinite Warfare. Bioshock 2, people know me. I absolutely adore Bioshock 2. I love that game with my whole heart and soul. Love the gameplay system of, you know, yes, there's regular typical enemy encounters, but there were a lot of moments where you could, you know what, this album's starting from the top. I'm gonna play something different. Give me just a minute. We're playing Chitlin Circuit. Shout out to, it's a Little Brother Day, man. I'm feeling Little Brother tonight. We're gonna keep with Little Brother. You can see the song I'm playing on the Twitch stream right below me, by the way. You probably already knew that, hopefully. But in any case, we're going to continue on this. Bioshock 2, I loved how you pick up little sisters and you're taking them to different little corpses with Adam on them. And you have an opportunity to set up. Before you drop her down, you can put down all your vortex traps, put down all your bow and arrow electric lines and stuff, and really set yourself up for battle in a way that felt really reminiscent of like tower defense games. Something like Sanctum, if you've ever heard of that game on PC, where it's tower defense. But as a first-person shooter, I just love stuff like that. I absolutely adore games like that. And Bioshock 2 is just crack for me in that way. I think what's going to be the deciding factor here is the fact that Bioshock 2 has outstanding gameplay. Just wonderful, wonderful, wonderful gameplay. I love that gameplay. But when it comes to the narrative, I got to keep it 100%. I know this is the main reason why people look at Bioshock 2 as a lesser game. Narratively, despite some moments sticking out, some moments being cool, some characters being cool, overall it doesn't really stick with me in the same way that the narrative of Call of Duty Infinite Warfare sticks with me. And that doesn't feel fair because it's still, I mean, gorgeous world still, you know, and the little sisters, Big Daddy, and even the big sisters now, that whole dynamic is really fun, really awesome. But Call of Duty Infinite Warfare has that great Call of Duty combat that we all know and love, with the really compelling upgrade systems that more Mass Effect-y type tone allows it to have. It's fun, but the narrative is still there too. So, And plus the gameplay in the multiplayer was really fun as well. I think overall, Call of Duty Infinite Warfare gave me more hours of enjoyment and was a bigger, wider center of pleasure for me as a game, where Bioshock 2, I've played it twice actually. I played it on PlayStation 3, PlayStation Plus gave it away, and I played it on PlayStation 4 through the Bioshock Collection as well. I actually played a decent chunk of that multiplayer in Bioshock 2, but I'm not even going to let that factor in, because despite me playing quite a bit of it, it just doesn't stick out, and there weren't even that many people playing it when I did play it. So we're going to go ahead and choose Call of Duty Infinite Warfare here. That feels weird because I'm the big Bioshock 2 guy, but if I got to be real with myself, Infinite Warfare is where it's at. Ooh, okay. Battle 57. Sunset Overdrive versus Call of Duty Modern Warfare 2019. Hot diggity damn. Took another sip there. Ooh. Now, Call of Duty Modern Warfare is kind of, I've changed my relationship with that just slightly in the last few weeks, because you've probably seen me on Twitter complain about the large file sizes with the updates for Modern Warfare. And when I say Call of Duty Modern Warfare, I mean 2019. It's just that game, I have it installed on my system right now. It literally takes up 150 gigs. If I still had a 500 gigabyte hard drive, that would literally be 25% of my entire hard drive space. And honestly, it's probably more because no one actually has 500 gigs on their hard drive available to use. So it's just really devastating in that respect. And it keeps me from being able to install other games to play through in my backlog. But the game itself is magnificent. I've said this before. The gun mechanics in Modern Warfare really makes it feel like you're trying to tame a wild dog, because it really feels like these are explosions happening in your hand and you're trying to tame them to keep them from shaking off of line, to try and keep the aim on your target. It's really compelling, and it just feels really fun to just get into any type of combat in that game because of it. Played a lot in the multiplayer. I think Prestige, they took out Prestiging, but I've played quite a bit of that multiplayer. I probably could look up the stats somewhere, but let's keep this a little bit more focused than we have in previous streams. Played a lot of that. I didn't really play much of the co-op. The co-op is kind of, you know, it's whatever. Plus, it's really hard to play if you're playing it by yourself, and that's a lot of situations I find myself in. Also, the single player, man. The single player is really cool. It's not my favorite. We just talked about Infinite Warfare. That's still my favorite Call of Duty campaign, but it was still very compelling. Some really gritty, just really shocking stuff you see in that campaign. And plus, I wasn't the biggest fan of the fact that there were no hit markers in the campaign, and that they really tried to make that realistic tone be felt through the gameplay in a way where the gameplay wasn't as fun as I would have liked it. But overall, I liked the campaign. And Warzone, that I've been playing recently, the recent free-to-play mode added to the game, Battle Royale, of course, I've really been enjoying that as well. And I've barely played it. I've played like maybe 2-3 matches of Battle Royale, Warzone, and the Plunder mode. But I've been having a blast. So I really enjoy Call of Duty Modern Warfare quite a bit. But in the case of Sunset Overdrive, I really enjoy that game too. Like, I just love that tone. I love the vibrancy. I love the fuck you attitude of that game. But not like a fuck you as in we hate you. Fuck you as in I'm doing what I want to do no matter what you say. I really enjoyed that tone. It's so vibrant, so brightly colored, and just so fun to be in. That's a world that's just a joy to be in, despite all of the, you know, soda pop zombies walking around. I enjoy just existing in that world. Tonally, character-wise, it's just so much fun. All the characters are, you know, pretty archetypal of different stereotypes, but I enjoyed them. My custom created character was, you know, fun to use, fun to see them interact with everyone else. And the movement system really did remind me of Infamous 2, where, you know, grinding on the rails and trying to find the best line up a wall where you got to use different obstacles like bounce pads and wall running and, you know, different aspects of the environment you have to use for traversal. And they kind of took that from Infamous 2. Not saying they like stole that idea, but that's something similar found in Infamous 2, and that's a big reason I like that game so much. But in Sunset Overdrive, it's just a little bit slower so that you can actually keep shooting people and keep taking aim while you're, you know, traversing the environment. And also it's easier to chain them together when it's a little bit slower. But which one do I like more? Feel like overall, if I did the Infinite Warfare versus Bioshock 2 comparison, just the breadth of different types of great content in Modern Warfare is probably going to win out. But for as much as I do enjoy that campaign, Sunset Overdrive's campaign just really hit me in the nerve. Like, if Sunset Overdrive had a Battle Royale mode, had a versus multiplayer mode, and had, you know, what, a co-op. There is actually co-op in Sunset Overdrive. Just never got the chance to play it because I never really tried. I guess I should sometime. But if all those existed and it had parity with Call of Duty Modern Warfare as far as modes and everything, I think I would still enjoy Sunset Overdrive more. Really what it comes down to is a comfort food argument. Call of Duty Modern Warfare is one of my favorite comfort food games, because it's just fun every time, great unlock system, and it's just really satisfying to play moment to moment. Where Sunset Overdrive is just, hell yeah, I like this aesthetic, hell yeah. Like, I have more fun being a fan of Sunset Overdrive, where Call of Duty Modern Warfare is just like, of course, yeah, I'm playing Call of Duty, yeah, it's fun, it's a great game. Like, there's something in the DNA of that gameplay that is just fun every time. Where Sunset Overdrive feels like, yo, y'all really just created a world that I'm just in love with, and a tone and all this other stuff that I just really, really dig. So as I pour myself some more Gatorade, I think the choice is clear here. We're going to choose Sunset Overdrive for this one. Sorry, Modern Warfare, you will get your day in the sun. And that day might be today. Battle number 58. Assassin's Creed Origins versus Call of Duty Modern Warfare 2019. Oh, God, that's the last of my Gatorade. I got to make more. Oh, sweet Jesus. How do we want to handle this one? Assassin's Creed Origins versus Modern Warfare 2019. The exploration, I keep saying this whenever Origins pops up, the exploration in that game is amazing. One of the main reasons I'm excited to go back to that game at some point. I just enjoyed running into tombs and finding all types of things. And yes, combat was pretty great. I really did enjoy the combat, but really it's the exploration is what made Origins so fun to me and how rewarding that game was for all of those aspects. And then I've already talked about Modern Warfare at length in the last battle. I think this is the one. And plus, I love Origins taking place in Africa. You know, we never get games like that. We rarely get games like that. So I enjoyed that. I think I'm going to have to vote for Modern Warfare here, though, because I played Assassin's Creed Origins for like a good 50 hours, and I can play it for another 50 hours just because I have so much content in there. DLC included. I bought the DLC. I just never touched it. I think I'm going to vote for Modern Warfare, though. That feels bad. That don't feel right. I feel it down here in my lower abdomen or whatever. It just don't feel like I should vote for that. I'm going to vote for Modern Warfare over Assassin's Creed Origins. Yeah, I'm going to have to do it. Assassin's Creed Origins is my favorite Assassin's Creed. But Modern Warfare is one of my favorite Call of Duties. And generally, I like Call of Duty more than Assassin's Creed. I washed my hands earlier, so that's I can touch my face and not die. I'm going to go ahead and say Modern Warfare for this one. I don't feel great about that, but I do think that's probably on point. That one hurt, man. That one hurt. So let's go on here. Assassin's Creed Syndicate versus Fallout 3 for battle number 59. All right. Let's say Assassin's Creed Syndicate versus Fallout 3. Now, I've talked about Fallout 3. I enjoy that game. So many great moments. Tranquility Lane, Liberty Prime, all that stuff. Great exploration as well. Talked about that. Graphically, it's ugly. Gameplay-wise, it's not fun to shoot, which is why VATS exists. And just stuff like that. It's just it's a little bit frustrating, especially to come back to really get into Fallout 3. Where Syndicate, man, I could if I played Syndicate sight unseen, never having played before, right now in the current landscape of video games, I would be having a lot of fun with Syndicate. Or Fallout 3, played it right now sight unseen, still playing the rest of the games that are coming out around now, it would feel. Its age is just so much there. It's just so hard to just play that game moment to moment, where I enjoy the memories that I had, and I respect the framework it laid out for other games of its ilk. But Assassin's Creed Syndicate, satisfying combat, you know, really satisfying stealth mechanics, where in Assassin's Creed games, the stealth usually isn't like a big deal to me. It wasn't until Origins where I was really like worried about like trying to be stealthy and maybe taking out areas without being seen. Syndicate is one of the first games that like really made it fun to be stealthy, especially in those assassination missions. I have a plate of chips in front of me, which is, you know, I'm really trying not to eat because I don't want to eat in the mic. I'll just drink in front of the mic because that sounds less bad. But I think I'm going to choose Assassin's Creed Syndicate. That don't feel right. That don't feel right. Because Fallout 3 was one of my top 10 favorite games of all time before I did the sorted list. That's just one of the things I put on there. And I replaced it with Horizon Zero Dawn when that came out. But are my memories of Fallout 3 better than that of... I think Syndicate's a better game, but I think I like Fallout 3 more. I think that's what it's coming down to. Where Fallout 3 just had a lot of cool... It had a lot of cool RPG systems as well. I can't forget that. Some really cool narrative moments that had implemented my choices into it. I think I'm going to have to vote for Fallout 3. It feels bad because I really feel if this was an objective list, Syndicate would have won over Fallout 3. But I'm going to go ahead and vote for Fallout 3 because I think I just have more positive memories and more great things to say. Or Assassin's Creed is just... Assassin's Creed is great throughout, or Fallout 3 is good throughout and then has peaks of amazingness, which is better than great. So I'm going to choose Fallout 3. Oh, okay, this is an easier one. Battle number 60, Assassin's Creed 2 versus Assassin's Creed Syndicate at 16% sorted. This one's going to be easy. It's Syndicate. Syndicate, we've already talked about it. Great combat. You know, they took a lot of elements from Batman at this point, so where it played pretty much like an Arkham game. So great combat, interesting characters, and the assassination missions were really, really compelling in that game, really entertaining. So that one's going to win. Assassin's Creed 2. Appreciate the foundation you laid once again. And I really like those quiet, you know, places where you fall underground and you have to climb your way out and find the best path that way. I love those levels. But overall, Syndicate's where it's at. Battle number 61. Uncharted 2 Among Thieves versus Uncharted Lost Legacy. Whew, spicy. Now, this is one I talk about on Twitter all the time. Uncharted 2... is the classic, man. That's the one everyone loves. That's the one everyone talks about for the series. That's the benchmark that everyone's still trying to hit. You know, you got the train sequence. You got, you know, the whole Shambhala sequence. You got a lot of that stuff in there. And you got, I don't know, you got the village. There's just a lot of good things in Uncharted 2. A lot of great stuff in there. But Lost Legacy, man. Lost Legacy... especially playing it right after Uncharted 4, Lost Legacy was such a breath of fresh air where it was an Uncharted game that did a couple of new things. And it felt like if you made an Uncharted game with an indie mindset, but with a AAA budget, where the game never felt like it was slacking or missing in content or features or any of that. But it was just trying, the stakes were not as high. It wasn't trying to find a secret world and save the entire planet, even though, you know, the ending kind of turned into something similar to that. The stakes never felt that high. It felt like a more grounded, more realistic story. And the fact that you're primarily just exploring one environment, or not one environment, one location the entire game, it made it feel like, instead of in Uncharted where these different locations you're going to are really just set dressing and really just something to make the visuals look, you know, varied and different. Lost Legacy, you really get deep and intertwined into that location, and it ties into the character of Chloe with her Indian heritage. It really, you get to go deep into it, which I really appreciated. It kind of like a slightly more contemporary Shadow of the Colossus type vibe when you think of it from a gameplay design perspective or in an environmental design perspective, just staying in one place and getting intimate with it. So yeah, I'm gonna have to vote for Lost Legacy here. I think overall it's just a more interesting game, more compelling game, where Uncharted 2 was just a great, excellent, damn near perfect ride from start to finish. I think Lost Legacy is just... actually, this is a similar argument for Ratchet & Clank A Crack in Time versus Ratchet & Clank 2016, where Uncharted 2 is Ratchet & Clank 2016, where it's that highlight reel, does a whole bunch of cool shit, bounces from place to place, but Lost Legacy is the one where it feels like it's taking some creative decisions, and it's doing some new stuff for the franchise that I really appreciate. And plus, train sequences in Lost Legacy, miles better than the train sequence in Among Thieves. So that's really all I got to say on that one. Lost Legacy it is. Battle number 62. Titanfall 2 versus Inside. Ha. Yeah, I'm going to have to do it. I'm going to have to do it to him. I feel guilty. I love Inside. I think, you know, animations are excellent. Narrative excellent. You know, everything everyone says about Inside. You know I love about Inside. That ending, ridiculous. I still think about that ending sometimes. It's awesome. But Titanfall 2, like we've talked about comfort food. Titanfall 2 is one of those rare games that manages to be comfort food, but it still gives me that adrenaline rush of the first time I played it. Like every match, you get into a good match of like attrition or even pilots v pilots. Those matches are always intense, always awesome, always fun. And narratively, you know, the campaign is still great. Great set pieces in the campaign. Just really fun to play through. Some great characters and stuff. Titanfall 2 is the complete package. And compared to Inside, which I love and adore, but ultimately it is a slightly more disposable experience because it was over fairly quickly. It showed you a lot of stuff. It's kind of like a smaller scale Uncharted 2 as far as the mindset is, where it's like, here's the next set piece, here's the next thing to do, here's the next, you know, whatever. Where Titanfall 2, even if it is the same maps, the same guns, you can use, there's so many different combinations that every moment on the battlefield is different and fun. So I really enjoy that, Titanfall 2. And plus, Titanfall 2 is part of the brand. The helmet's over there. So, yeah, gonna click Titanfall 2. Ooh, battle number 63, Shadow of the Colossus versus Inside. Huh, gee willikers. Shadow of the Colossus versus Inside. I think I'm still gonna have to go Shadow of the Colossus. Just because, you know, the scale of the Colossus, you know, everything that's impressive about that scale. But also for someone like me, I played this back on PS3 before, you know, I was playing. That's back when I played a lot more different games. But this is one of the first games that got me on that journey of getting outside of my comfort zone of, you know, shooters and action adventure games. Shadow of the Colossus was about, it was not just about killing the Colossus. It was about finding out how to even get onto them, then finding out where their weak spot even is. Like that whole dynamic was just so cool, so amazing to me, in a way where that wow moment of, oh, this is how you figure it out, you get that multiple times. You get that 16 times. I think there's 16 Colossus. Yeah, 16 Colossus, you get that 16 times in that game. Where Inside, the big wow moment happens at the end. There are a bunch of smaller wow moments throughout, but the biggest one happens at the very end. And so I think that balance of wow is tilted in the favor of Shadow of the Colossus. So we're going to go ahead and vote for that one. Oh, here's another hard one. Battle 64, The Last of Us versus Nier Automata. Shit my dick. This one's going to be hard. Now, we already know The Last of Us. I love The Last of Us. Replayed it recently on its second hardest difficulty so I can get that platinum. Haven't gotten it yet. Got to play a lot of multiplayer. But Last of Us is one of those games where everyone loves the story. I really don't have to talk about the narrative too much. But the combat is really good. Like, of course, I love it in the single player. But even in the multiplayer, dude, that combat is solid. It's tense. It's brutal. It's just really, it's really visceral combat, and I like it. Despite it not being the most MLG precise combat out there, I really enjoy Last of Us's combat. Nier Automata is another game that I enjoy the combat in that game so much, but I enjoy the ways in which Nier Automata is your own game. Like with it, there's a moth in my fucking room. No, is that a gnat? It's attracted to the light of the screen, and it's just crawling. Apologies ahead of time if it crawls over the screen, the light, the camera, but hopefully that won't happen. Apologies. Ooh, boy. Nier Automata is one of those games where I appreciated how you made the game yours, because it has RPG elements. You can add your own upgrades, you know, you're making 2B faster, do more damage, all this stuff as you go on. And also 9S, not to spoil too much of the game, but I really dug how you had different, because the upgrade system wasn't a traditional upgrade system. It wasn't a skill tree where you pick and choose your skills out of a set list. You just, all the enemies in the game drop different chips, and you can slot the chip in to your completely blank slate of a character. So you can have literally any type of buff you want. You want to widen your window for slow motion dodges? You can do that. You want to increase your damage with certain weapons? You can do that. You want to add health generation? You can do that. You want to add an ability for your little gun turret to shoot automatically while you're attacking enemies? You can do that. You can have all these just almost endless options that change gameplay in a very impactful way. And I just really dug that. And then on top of that, Nier Automata has a wonderful, wonderful story and a really mind-fucky story as well. It has a lot of twists and turns, really blows your expectations out of the water in a lot of ways. And the final act of that story really just like had my jaw on the floor. I was like, whoa, what the hell is happening? Who even thought? It gets to the point where it's like, who the hell could think of a narrative like this? Who the hell would think gameplay wise to end a game like this? Like, it's just some really brilliant outside of the box thinking there, and I loved every minute of it. Now I'll admit, it took me a while to get into it because everyone was saying Nier Automata is great, Nier Automata is great, blah blah blah, Nier Automata is great, and I like to think I don't have a snobbery when it comes to this stuff, but I have to admit, if a game is described as an anime game, it's not something that's going to sell me on it, which I know feels bad and is not fair. There's actually, I think, 2 anime games on my top 100, maybe more. But that whole aesthetic doesn't really attract me. So seeing Nier, I was like, all right, whatever. But people were talking it up so highly, so I had to try it, and I'm glad I did ultimately. But when it comes to the case of The Last of Us and Nier Automata, I think what's gonna do it is these narratives are both so iconic, so great, but gameplay wise Nier Automata is just more compelling. And that's so blasphemous, that's so wrong, that just don't feel right at all, but that's how I feel. Because The Last of Us is in my top 10, like the top 10 list that I've made beforehand. The Last of Us is up there. Ugh, man, I think here's what's going to have to come down to. How much do I love the ending? Because really, if that's what we're talking about here, narratively, they both are amazing. Gameplay-wise, I feel Nier Automata has an edge. Actually, not even. Nier Automata has an edge in the way that you have different options. The options of gameplay in Nier is wider than Last of Us, where Last of Us, you're doing the same thing throughout the whole game, but it's always fun and visceral. Yo, this shit gonna hurt. Whatever I choose is gonna hurt. I think we're gonna have... Because, like, the ending of The Last of Us is iconic. Or the ending of Nier Automata isn't really iconic. It's just crazy that it happened. That it is crazy that it exists. Like, if you told someone that that's how Nier Automata ends, you'd be like, what? How do you even do that? Why would you even do that? That's just so bold, so daring. But the ending of Last of Us is bold and daring in a completely different way. I think ultimately, I think I'm going to have to vote The Last of Us. It just won't feel right in my heart if I vote. If Nier Automata is above The Last of Us, it won't feel right to me. It just won't feel right. Like, it'll feel like I did something wrong. So I just don't want to do that. I love Nier Automata, but it very well could still be in my top 10. But Last of Us, I feel like, has to be up there. Just for as much as I love that game, for as much as I've played that game. And I just don't talk about it as much because it's a game everyone loves, but Nier Automata. Not Last of Us, I have to vote. I'm just going to do it before I stay here forever. Okay. Oh, okay, here, we got a good one. We got an easy one. Battle 65, Borderlands versus Nier Automata. For all the reasons we just got done saying, Nier Automata wins. Borderlands, I still do enjoy Borderlands. I enjoyed the original Borderlands more than I enjoy 2 in a lot of ways. It's more simplified loot. Progression systems are a lot more simplified. It's just an easier, more inviting game to play overall, for me at least. Narratively, it's kind of whatever, but you know, there's a comfort food quality to Borderlands, but Nier Automata is just a masterpiece, so we're gonna vote for Nier Automata here. Battle number 66, Borderlands versus Rise of the Tomb Raider. I think Rise of the Tomb Raider has to win again. Once again, I don't know if I'd call Rise of the Tomb Raider a masterpiece, but it certainly has the production value of one. Really cool set pieces. Really, you know, it's an interesting narrative. I'm not going to say it's a great narrative because there's some, you know, there's some whatever stuff in there, but a very interesting narrative. But it's really about the gameplay. It's fun to walk around, collect stuff, upgrade yourself. You know, set pieces were awesome. Really cool stuff. And of course, it's just a gorgeous game to look at. Where Borderlands feels almost like an indie game in its lack of ambition, where it's literally just you shoot, you loot, and there's a story, I guess. That's about it. So yeah, we're going to go ahead and choose Rise of the Tomb Raider for this one. Battle number 67. We're at 18% sorted, by the way. Tearaway versus Borderlands 2. Now, I feel weird. I can't eat the chips. I'm so close. Let me get through the rest of this. Borderlands 2, I've talked about previously in the previous podcasts or in the previous Twitch streams, because those only exist as Twitch streams now. I've talked about how Borderlands 2 is starting to change. I'm starting to change my opinion of it in retrospect, because I used to absolutely love that gameplay. But I've played so many other games with like actual great shooting mechanics that are satisfying every time, and not, oh, I have to find a good gun before the shooting feels great. Borderlands 2 kind of felt like that for me, where I was kind of fighting the weapons, trying to find the fun in, you know, some of the difficult gunplay and everything. Borderlands 2 kind of, I've waned on that, on my love for that series, or on my love for that specific title. Where Tearaway, man. Tearaway, I still feel very, very strongly about that game. That's one of my favorite Vita games. Just really moved me emotionally for reasons I don't understand. It's just when you show me something that cute for that long and let me get invested and then incorporate myself in the game with the camera and everything, it's just a match made in emotional jelly heaven, because that's what my heart turned into, emotional jelly. Tearaway, I have so many positive feelings on. With Borderlands 2, overall, I still have great memories of that game. When I beat it the first time, I loved it. But over the years, I've fallen off a little bit. And it's probably a big reason why I still haven't played much of my copy of Borderlands 3. So we're going to choose Tearaway here. Battle 68, Gone Home versus Borderlands 2. Couldn't think of a bigger gap between two different games. I think we're going to have to go with, I wouldn't feel right if Borderlands 2 was above Gone Home, so I think Gone Home's gonna win this one. Borderlands 2, like I said, enjoy that formula and everything. I enjoy all the different pieces of Borderlands 2, but when it comes together, in retrospect, I'm just not thinking of it as positively as I used to. Where Gone Home, that game's still so cool to me. Just the way it tells its story is really awesome, and I really haven't had that much in other games. So yeah, Gone Home, fantastic game, and really, you know, love is love type stuff. Like, I'm all about that life now, and I don't think Gone Home is like the game that made me, you know, care about LGBT rights, but it's just like, you know, I think I definitely was a bit mindful of my actions in relativity to that community than I was before I played that game. And it definitely wasn't overnight. You know, I didn't buy my fucking PlayStation Pride hat and shirt, the next day after playing Gone Home, but it, you know, it definitely bring in a glacier change in myself. So, you know, positive change is positive change, no matter how long it takes. So we're going to go ahead and click Gone Home for this one. Battle 69. All right, we got, oh wow, these are another two completely different games. One of these games you can make a 69 joke about. Far Cry 3 versus Walking Dead Season 1. Far Cry 3 definitely deserving of the Battle 69 moniker. Great open world game. Love it to death. One of my favorite games of all time. I crowned it as my favorite shooter of all time for many years. I think up until Doom 2016 came out. Or maybe until Titanfall 2 came out. One of the two. But yeah, I love Far Cry 3, you know, everything about it, exploration, combat, stealth, the ability to go into stealth and just clear out a whole base. I think Far Cry 3 is one of the first games that made that a thing I crave in games. Like, I think I did stuff like that in Deus Ex, but I would always fumble somewhere. I would always mess up the walking pattern or something like that. Or Far Cry 3 made it fun and easy to, like, take out entire base undetected. That was really, really fun. But Walking Dead Season 1, that narrative, I mean, I got a Walking Dead unboxing on my YouTube channel. If I ever have kids, if I ever have a daughter, I want to name her Clementine. There's just so many. Walking Dead Season 1 is a part of me as a person, where Far Cry 3 just gives me what I want. You know what I mean? Yeah, the impact of Walking Dead Season 1 is so much greater than Far Cry 3. And I love Far Cry 3, but Walking Dead Season 1 is really where it's at. So I got to vote for it. Ooh, the return of the Mac. Battle number 70 at 19% shorted. So, you know, we're getting close to the end here for this stream / podcast episode. Red Dead Redemption versus Red Dead Redemption 2. I really agonized. Now, when I did this on the last series of sorting streams, I really, really agonized on which one I would pick from these two. What I come down to... what I come down to is... Gameplay-wise, Red Dead Redemption is superior. Like, you want to talk about just straight-up gun combat, Red Dead Redemption is superior. It was just a snappier, more arcadey feel to that game that I overall just like more arcadey feeling shooters. So I love it for that. But the thing I think a lot of people forget is that Red Dead Redemption 1 is a classic, one of my favorite games of all time. I'm not going to say anything other than that. But I think people have a little bit of a rose-tinted glass or a rose-tinted glass situation with Red Dead Redemption 1 as I take my drink. Where we remember the big moments of Red Dead Redemption, you know, that ending and then that second ending, if you know what I mean. And then, you know, going to Mexico, that set piece, and, you know, driving the car in that one weird mission. And finding Dutch, you know, the big missions people remember. People don't always remember the weird side missions and the weird, like, vibe and tone that still felt a little bit juvenile and towards the, like, Grand Theft Auto / bully side of Rockstar. People forget about those parts of that game, where Red Dead Redemption 2 does not have any of that. And then on top of that, Red Dead Redemption 2, despite it alongside keeping a consistent tone, it just has such a more remarkable world that I just wanted to be a part of. It's not necessarily a world that I was like, man, I'd love to live here. It's not like, you know, Ratchet & Clank, Sunset Overdrive. It's not like that type of inviting. It feels fun to exist in that world. Not to where I'm like, oh man, I want to live in this world of, you know, cowboys dying and violence and death and sickness and all this shit. It's just really, like, it's just such a delightful place. It's like watching a nice painting. It's like when you see a painting, you're like, that's just fucking gorgeous. I'm gonna look at this for a minute. This one snapshot. Every now and then playing Red Dead Redemption 2, you'll get that snapshot. You'll be taking some pelts to the local shop to sell them. You'll be just at a campfire making some hollow point bullets. You'll just be doing some really arbitrary, small, meaningless task. And then the beauty of the world will just hit you. Not just visual beauty, but just like just all the systems working together, all of the characters working together, and how they can tell a story of that magnitude, a way better story than Red Dead Redemption 1, in a world that complicated, that wide, and that complex. It's just mind-blowing in so many ways. And I know I played a lot of the multiplayer in Red Dead Redemption 1. I prestiged, or whatever they call prestiging in Red Dead Redemption 1's multiplayer. But Red Dead Redemption 2 is just so remarkable to me. I love that game so much. And narratively, it had such a bigger impact on me than Red Dead Redemption 1. So yeah, I'm going to have to vote for Red Dead Redemption 2. I know people have issues with the slow combat and, you know, the slow pace of that game overall. But that was a positive for me overall. Now, I will say before I click it, I did have issues with the fact that I played 100 hours of the game and I was still only halfway through the epilogue. It was really frustrating. At a certain point, I was like, I just want to finish this fucking game. But all that time beforehand was still time well spent, where I never really felt like I just need this thing to be done for Red Dead Redemption. where I did feel like that in Red Dead Redemption 2. And I think that's, you know, they need to just speed up the pace of gameplay a little bit, you know, horse riding, gunplay, all that stuff. But I think it was worth it, because when that sluggishness was immersing me in the world, it was way better than Red Dead Redemption. But when that sluggishness got in the way of me getting to the end of the game, that's when it started to rear its ugly head. But luckily it was late enough into my playthrough where it didn't really count for me that as much, because I was almost done. So Red Dead Redemption 2, it is for this one. Battle number 71. Metro Last Light versus God of War 3. Gee willikers. Actually, this isn't that hard. God of War 3 wins. Just the epicness of the scale of those battles, just the fights you get into, the combat was fun. Using the Cestus for the first time was just so chunky and satisfying. Some of the things you could do with the blades, and some just the things you could do with enemies, you know, use them as battering rams, you can throw them, rip them in half on the spot. Just the complexities of combat in God of War 3, along with the scale and the beauty of the world, and just the crazy set pieces in that game, God of War 3 has to win. Where Metro Last Light, it's a very, I'm not even going to say it's a chill experience, it's a very meditative experience, it's a very relaxed game, but it's intense. It is very scary, it is very intense and, you know, immersive, and I think that's super novel. But overall, just the package of God of War 3 with all of the things that make that game great, Metro Last Light, you know, it's a novelty. I look at Metro Last Light as a great novelty, where God of War 3 is like a seminal game. It's like a seminal experience that I think most, if not all, people should play. So yeah, Metro Last Light, sorry, you will get your day in the sun as well, but God of War 3 is going to win this one. All right, battle number 72, Gears of War 5 versus Saints Row 4. Wow. Yeah, I always say Saints Row 4 is one of my favorite games of all time, and that's what's going to be the case here. Or I always say Saints Row 4 is my number one favorite game of all time. And considering how some of these votes have gone, I think that's in trouble. That might be in threat, but we'll see as we keep playing. Gears of War 5, I love that game. You know, I think it's gorgeous. I think the whole open world environments and the pace of its narrative and gameplay just were a perfect harmony, and I love that game with all my heart. Saints Row 4, though, it's the thing I talk about, man. I love just running around, gliding around, getting upgrades, taking out enemies, taking out a bunch of enemies at once, how you feel like a god by the end of that game. You can literally cause nuclear explosions by just slamming yourself into the ground from high enough of a vantage point. I really, wow, I just realized they said, "I'm diarrhea, nigga, you are not ready for the shit" on this Little Brother song. That's an aggressive phrase. So yeah, just everything about Saints Row 4. Narratively, I love those characters. I love how all of the single player missions in Saints Row 4, all the main missions, were like random set pieces related to the character that they're about. And I thought that was so unique, and it made for so much more. There's no filler in the story missions of Saints Row at all. There's no filler. It's all bombastic, big budget moments. All of the filler is relegated to just the side missions and stuff. And if you don't want to play the side missions, you don't have to. It's just a really cool way of doing a game, where a lot of games will be like, all right, you're playing through the main campaign, and you can tell there's like smaller parts that are supposed to be more low key for the pace. Now, all the main missions in Saints Row 4 slap. So yeah, I absolutely adore that game. I'm going to vote for it here. I love and respect Gears, but it's not a contest for me on this one. Oh, wow. And with that, we have gotten to 20% sorted. I think that took less time than it did last time. We had 35 battles to get to 10% sorted. And now we are at 73. Actually, it took a little longer. It took 73. Took a little longer. But, you know, time-wise, we did beat our estimate for the last episode. So yeah, there's actually a pretty good matchup here that we'll start with on the next episode. So be on the lookout for that. I'll give you guys a little hint. It's a PlayStation exclusive versus an Xbox exclusive. And if you know me, you probably know which Xbox exclusive that is. But Hey, the PlayStation one is up for debate. So you guys will find that out in the next episode. We are on 20% sorted after 73 battles. We will get all the way to 100% sorting soon enough. But for now, I'm going to go ahead and take a break. I'm shut in because of this, you know. We're not on quarantine necessarily, but, you know, coronavirus is a thing all around the world right now. I will be at home if I am not at work for the next 2 weeks. So I will have plenty of time to do some more of these. This one will be going out. I'm thinking what I'll do is make this a rare weekend podcast, because our typical Players Club podcast episodes, those always go up on Wednesdays, except for this past Wednesday because my week has been crazy. But those usually go up on Wednesdays, so I think I'm going to make this this top 100 games podcast. I think I'm going to make that just a Sunday podcast. That way I can get those in right before I go to work most of the time. And, you know, there's a little less editing on this one because it's just one audio track. No segments or anything. I just got to cut off some fat at the bottom and fat at the top sometimes. But other than that, we'll go ahead. We'll put these out on Sundays. This episode will be going out on this incoming Sunday. I don't want to say an exact time. You guys know, if you're watching the stream, you know, I'm notorious for having my plans not go as I would like them to. But, yeah, you guys will be seeing this as a podcast soon enough. I'm going to try and stick to that Sunday time, but, you know, pray for me if it don't work. But yeah, we'll come back to this battle. I know for everyone on the Twitch stream, they know exactly what this battle is. But for everyone listening, you guys will hear what it is later. So without further ado, we're going to go ahead and wrap this up. Thank you all for listening, watching, following along. Hopefully you guys, if you guys aren't watching the Twitch stream, that's fine. If you guys don't pay attention to any of this stuff, that's fine. But like, I feel like it's more digestible as a podcast format. So do go out there, go to VGU.TV. Actually, let's go ahead and do that on the stream. If you go to VGU.TV, you will see the podcast version of my top 100 game sorting, or at least the first one of that. This will be episode 2. I will put it out labeled as episode 2, where people can go back and listen to the first one. But yes, that's all I have today. I'm going to go ahead and wrap this up before we get to 2 hours. So as you know, I've been Emmett Watkins Jr., also known as EJSponge61 on all places around the internet. Thank you all for watching or listening, and I'll see you in the next one. And as I always say, keep it real, keep it true. Bye-bye, y'all.